Hello, everyone. It's Wednesday on Your View. Welcome to the show. I am Murayo Afolabi Brand, and always I have the ladies, YK, in the building.
Yo, yo, yo. Good morning. Good morning.
We are somewhat similar today.
You are flying with everybody. You're flying with yeah,
yes,
you're
yes.
flying with me.
Yes, yes.
So.
How you doing, YK?
Yeah, yeah.
How you doing, YK?
I'm fine. I'm fine. I went to Abeokuta on Monday. Mm. Okay. You know, my grandmother, the Ogun State government did the Kuti Heritage Museum, so we had to go and meet the Ministry of Tourism there. And guess where we stayed? Because we were trying to renovate my grandmother's house, one of her houses, so that the family, because we stay in hotels when we go there. Mm. So we said, that's strain of the soil, let's renovate the house. So we've done the four flats, but NEPA, right.
You guys didn't plan for generator?
We haven't got the generator there yet.
It,
and guess where we stayed?
Governor's Lodge.
Chief Oduntong.
Oh, oh,
that's sweet.
Oh, he's a very good host. He's a very good host.
Tell me.
Wow. He's a very good host.
It was very nice.
He stayed in his house.
We stayed in his house, all of us.
Wow.
Oh, that's nice. He's a very good host. I've been there. I've been there.
Yeah, I haven't.
It was very nice. He showed us all the TV programs. He's been on Review.
That his living room with the TV screen and everything. He has everything almost on autoplay.
Yes, give me a bottle of champagne.
Oh,
yeah,
my God.
He knows you.
He has finished you.
Wants to give Mike a champagne.
That is it.
That is it.
Your butter.
Good.
That is maligning me. They are maligning my
But that's good. But what was I going to say, YK? They said that your area is one of the prone areas for flooding. Maybe you start thinking about it too.
Ah.
Alagbole.
Let me just, I'm putting it in prayer that Governor Abiodun will do finish tarring the road
before the flood.
Because right now, I mean, we are smooth sailing.
Okay.
In Alagbole.
That's good. Did you tell the minister, the commissioner for.
I told the commissioner, I said, please help us tell him.
Tell the that you're happy with
because
him.
Because I'm hoping to meet him.
That, yes.
Yeah, thank you.
This is in the building, entrepreneur, speaker, leader, businessman, you know.
That's it.
You've gone global
now.
That's
how I'm global now. Yeah, not serious.
How are you doing?
I'm amazing and grateful. I just want to give a shout out to my customers. You guys have been amazing. Like, money wakes me up these days.
Oh.
I woke up the day before yesterday with bang, 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 and I just picked my phone. I said, ooh. And then I rushed off and I started packing my products. And my husband was like, you did not even hug me. You did not even tell me good morning. I said, sorry, baby, I'm coming back to you.
I hope the tax people are listening to you.
No, come on now. I don't even have a store.
Your proper company. Don't worry, she'll get that. She'll get
I just hope they are listening to her because it is me that will come and meet that. I don't have money.
I don't have a store. I don't have a physical store.
But you are making money.
Hey, I'm selling online.
Don't worry.
It's not people with store that they tax. It's people who make money.
Why can you not nice?
But the point is that, you see, I like the fact that you start a business and it's doing well. Yes. It's so important because a lot of people are looking for opportunities out there. And when they see you, you do hair, you do you started the clothing line.
I launched my clothing line.
You know, which is fantastic.
I relaunched my clothing line, actually.
So, and it's called House of Beecee, right?
Yeah, House of
Beecee. So, we support you.
I'm doing it. Thank you.
I just can't support you now because I just got like, in fact, I mean, people sent me, somebody, Daisy Couture, I believe, sent me like 10 bags. I've not opened it though.
Wow.
It's still in my living room. I'm not even, because another person sent a pillow from UK to come and measure me, bought some clothes.
Wow.
So, in fact, at this
Take
point,
your time, girl.
I want to remove some clothes from my wardrobe. Like, I'm giving out, I'm in batches. I usually do that every 6 months, but now I have to do it.
Me too, I need clothes though.
We all need clothes. You know, I'm your size, actually.
No, you do.
I am. Selling clothes. What kind of clothes are you selling?
African outfits.
Oh, really?
You will support me because you like everything African.
Okay.
I'll send you pictures.
I'm just sharing it for the first time on set.
I am.
You tell me.
I am.
No, anyways, it's Wednesday.
I know you will.
We have a lot to cover today. Because an ex-minister set the social media on fire yesterday. We'll talk about it a bit later. But first, let's go through the front pages of the papers. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Okay, we're going to start with The Nation. Chinese loans, row grows in-house over investigation. Picture here of our president with Zamfara State Governor Bello Matawalle saying that foreigners are paying gold with arms. CBN banks to save jobs in aviation and media sectors. Nigeria has defeated polio, says Buhari. NAFDAC, chloroquine kills COVID-19 at early stage. Fani-Kayode under fire for attacking reporter. lots of stories. Okay, let's take the NAFDAC first.
Yes. So the Director General of the NAFDAC, that's a Professor Mojisola Adeyeye, yesterday stated that they've studied and understood that chloroquine can actually kill COVID-19, but it's just at the early stages. Right. They also followed up on another drug, which is remdesivir, which would kill COVID-19 at the late stages. So you can actually use both drugs, and it's cheaper to treat. A lot of West African countries are treating COVID-19 with the chloroquine because it's cheaper. It's that you get it for like $10. But with that other medicine, remdesivir, you can pay as much as $2,500. So they had to speak with the manufacturer, and he explained to them how it actually cures. They had to do a clinical trial with that drug and found out that it actually cures, but at late stages.
So the Zamfara state governor is calling out, and he went to the presidential villa to speak to the president on this issue, the fact that bandits are actually using illegal mining to mine gold and take that in exchange for arms. And that in itself, obviously, that's how they're that the influx of ammunition in that community.
That's how they're able to fund the terrorism as well.
And so he was asking for the advice of what the president can do to help ensure that this can be curtailed.
Yes. So in another story, he also mentioned that they are trying to engage with the local miners of the gold so that they buy, even with their limited resources, they can buy from them and, you know, find a way to cut off the market, because it's actually foreigners who are buying, and instead of paying cash, they give them arms. Right. And that's why we have a lot of influx.
Okay. All right, let's move on to the punch. States to spend security bailout on COVID-19 pay. Amoteku and troops. Flood kills 3, destroys 150 houses in Bauchi. Ogun serial killer smoked out with technology before death, says Commissioner of Police. Akeredolu unveils 953-member campaign team for governorship poll. We are spending $6.15 billion funding power sector, says Minister. Heavy flooding will hit Lagos, FCT, Rivers, others from September 6th, says NIHSA. And WHO officially declares Africa polio-free, says status. Okay,
major
headline, please.
Yes, so the state governors had a meeting with the president on the 11th of August, and they were asking for bailout funds to be able to fund their security outfits. A lot of them complained that they struggled during COVID-19. They had even reached into their security votes to be able to, you know, attend to the security issues in the state. And so they would need extra. They need the bailout funds. And so they made a clear distinction of what the bailout funds were and what the security votes were. Security votes are what has been approved for them on a monthly basis to, you know, handle the security architecture. But now the bailout fund is additional money that they are going to be using. So I am worried, if you are getting security votes, why do you still need to ask for bailout funds? Is it that the security votes are not enough?
They're using the bailout funds to fund the police.
Yes.
Which is not, because the police is federal, so they want to fund their own security agencies.
Like
yes.
Okay, so I was going to take the story where the minister is saying that $6.15 billion has been used, is being actually secured for power. I mean, we spend so much on power, but this is the breakdown of what they're going to use, of how they're going to spend that money. They're saying $2.3 billion is for the Siemens deal. We know Siemens came to come and help us in providing more megawatts. While $1.6 billion was for transmission rehabilitation, $1.7 is for distribution, and $550 million for Nigerian electricity project. Now, for us, this is still a bit ambiguous. Yes, we understand the needs, but it's important for us to know exactly how this is going to pan out, because what Nigerians are saying right now is that we need meters, first of all.
Yes, we do.
After now, because according to what we know, is that what we're generating, we're not even consuming to the level that we're generating. So provide us meters first. So I'm not sure if metering is part of this this breakdown, but either way, they've approved the money, and they'll be getting that money for power generation. Moving on now to Daily Sun. FG issues flood alert for Nasarawa, Kebbi, Rivers, Anambra, 6 others. I'll focus on 9 priority areas in remaining parts of my tenure, says Buhari. 2023 coalition sets up committee to shop for Igbo president. NAF jets kill top ISWAP commanders in Borno. And UNILAG Governing Council approves Ogunshola's appointment as acting VC. Okay.
The Nigeria Hydrological Service Agency have issued a warning that the river in Chad, Niger Republic, is swelling and they're opening the dams. Mm. So Niger, Benue are going to get flooded. And so in that case, everybody is going to have flooding problems during the rains, according to them, from September 6th.
So yes.
They should start preparing.
Lagos inclusive.
Lagos inclusive.
Yes. Everybody, and they said that it's on a red alert zone. What that means is that there's nothing they can do. The water has reached that level. The dams will be open. And I think we had a conversation yesterday. Yes, listen, guys, this is our reality. Find a safe zone, because people, I mean, in Jigawa was also one state, three people have already died from flooding. So we need, I think it was Bauchi. Yeah. So people must actually begin to prepare for that flood.
What I also, you know, because these pure water bottles and
sachets
and the bottles, I mean, in front of our house in Abeokuta,
that place
it gets flooded, the water comes in, it's terrible.
Okay.
I'm really afraid.
Daily Sun. Okay, we talked about the coalition.
I want to take that now. Yes. So, coalition of Southeast youth leaders have set up a committee known as the Igbo Presidential Actualization Committee to shop for a suitable president of the Igbo candidate extraction in 2023. So they are saying that they are going to go round all the sectors, all the state zones to fish out Igbos that are doing amazing in their different profession, their different fields. And they are also likely going to send a letter to those politicians who have aspiration to go for 2020 to step down and support the Igbo extraction.
Yes, like Atiku and others. Yes, so they say that please step aside and allow us to have that position.
Politics is interesting in this
country. Very. Moving on now to the Nigerian Tribune. Power project FG to deliver 300 megawatts to every state, secure 6.1 billion fund. We talked about that. Let's find a story we've not taken. Africa declared polio free.
The polio.
Benue government owes state pensioners 25 months. LG pensioners 17 months. Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Makinde moved to conduct local government election. I didn't read that story. I would have loved to read that story. But go ahead, Mike. Let's talk about the polio.
Yeah, no, it's just that Africa has been declared polio free. This was given to us by Dr. Funsho. He says up to 2016, we had cases, like four cases.
Yeah.
But since then till now, so we have now been declared polio-free. They battled it with mobile apps and...
Yeah, to trace it. So WHO has finally presented us that certification that we're not
polio-free. But they are also...
You know, on this same show, we were declared polio-free. We did the celebration here.
And then...
2 weeks later.
that's the four cases that happened in the North.
So
yeah, but they were also appealing.
My sister did have polio when she was a child.
Oh.
So...
Wow.
We're also,
a terrible disease.
Yes, the World Health Organization was also appealing that we need to be very careful. The vaccines should still be given to children because it can be transferred from one country to another. So let's not relax because... Yeah.
Okay, final paper. We run out of time. Fani-Kayode under fire for attacking Daily Trust reporter. Don't worry, we'll talk about that a bit later. That's Daily Trust. Foreigners buy gold. We talked about that. Let's find a story we've not taken. Governors to pay community police officer salaries, force headquarters. Okay, I don't think there's any other story we've not taken there. Vanguard, very quickly. Economy, industry leaders warn of gloom ahead. What I'll do in remaining part of my tenure, says Buhari. Edo, I'm not working to rig for Obaseki, says ex-INEC staff. Many states asking for state police can't pay salaries. Interesting story. Go ahead.
The president with the diplomat. Yes. So yesterday, the president, Muhammadu Buhari, revealed to eight diplomats from different countries, that he has nine priority things he wants to do for the remaining of his tenure, which is to build a thriving and sustainable economy, enhance social inclusion, reduce poverty, enlarge agricultural output for food security, export, attain energy sufficiency, and the others. And he's saying that he wants them to, you know, come into the country, take a look at what's happening, and support us the way that they can.
On that note, that's all we can take a front page view. When we come back, we have a guest appearance from SMB. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Stay tuned. Your View will be right back. Welcome back to Your View.
Thanks for staying with us. So, on Monday, August 24th, Facebook announced a 500 million grant, 500 million naira grant to support 781 small businesses in Nigeria as part of the $100 million global grant program announced earlier this year. which aims to support 30,000 small businesses in over 30 countries. Now, this was to stimulate the economy and recover from COVID-19. It also empower and extend a lifeline to small businesses across Africa. Joining us now on the show is the head of policy, Anglophone West Africa, Facebook. West Africa and Facebook, Adaora Ikenze. Good morning, Ada.
Good morning, Mariah. Good morning. Nice to speak to you again.
Yes, good to have you on the show. So, 500 million naira is about to be given out, obviously, to small businesses in Nigeria. Could you tell us what this is about exactly, and how do we benefit from this?
So basically, we recognize that the COVID-19 crisis is not just a public health crisis. It's an economic crisis. And small businesses are really the ones most impacted by this crisis. We worked with the OECD and the World Bank, and we commissioned a study, which we recently published, called The State of Small Businesses, which looked at small businesses on our platform across 50 countries, including Nigeria. And the results were really quite troubling. We saw that people were having challenges retaining staff, challenges engaging with their customers, challenges building their businesses, challenges accessing finance and resources. And one of the ways that we are trying to support small businesses, not only to remain viable, but also to overcome this crisis, is to provide this grant support.
So how do you choose the businesses that eventually get this grant? What are some of the criteria that they have to meet to be able to be selected?
So it is a grant. These are grants that will be given to for-profit businesses. And you do not have to be on Facebook to apply for these grants. The criteria is relatively simple. You should be a small business, a registered small business. You should be able to provide proof of your registration and of all the documents that would be required of you, such as proof of your tax returns and your staff strength. We ask that you should have a minimum of 2 staff members, and you should be in business for at least 1 year. But all the criteria is listed on the grant application, which is very, very easy to access. People can just go to facebook.com/grantsforbusinesses.
Yeah. Wow. Is Facebook partnering with any other organization on this?
So we're working with our global partners, Deloitte, who will manage the grant program and the disbursement of the funds. And then locally in Nigeria, we're working with the Faith Foundation and AfriGrants, who will also be providing support.
Okay, so now, how do you apply? And then, because we expect that there'll be loads of people applying, how do you plan to sift through the application process and then arrive at your final list?
So we have dedicated 500 million naira to Nigeria. And we recognize that there are lots of small businesses in Nigeria, but we also want to be able to give as much opportunity to viable businesses to apply. So what we have done is we have staggered the process. So from Monday the 24th, applications opened in 3 regions of the country. And from today, applications will open for the further 3 regions in the country. And all applications will be open for 10 days.
Okay, nice. So you know that we are large and diverse, and we have a lot of businesses in, you know, across cities. So how do you ensure that people from smaller cities still get the opportunity to, you know, get involved in this?
This is the reason why we have made sure that the grant application is open to every single region of Nigeria. Okay. And this is the reason why we have set it in a staggered process, so that there will be opportunity from people from Yenagoa to Yaba to apply.
Right, fantastic.
Why are you focusing on small businesses? The reason, and How small must your business be? My, you call me to have business. So.
Like I said, you know, all we ask is that you have a minimum of 2 employees, verifiable employees, and that you've been in business for at least a year. And we're focusing on small businesses because, like I said, when we commissioned this study, and this is a study that was done globally across 50 countries, including Nigeria, we recognized that we saw that small businesses are the ones really, really suffering the brunt of the COVID-19 pandemic. Larger businesses have a certain amount of resources that they can rely on, that has been able to carry them through. I'm not saying that larger businesses are not struggling or they don't have challenges, but small businesses who traditionally have smaller pots of savings or smaller budgets to reach out to customers, or smaller budgets for marketing, smaller budgets or smaller access to financing to tide them through rough times, are the ones who have really, really, really been hit by this global pandemic. That's why we are joining forces globally, really, to try and support small businesses. We also recognize the power of small businesses on our platform. We know that a lot of small businesses have used our platform to reach out, to engage, to build their businesses. And we want to be able to support not just businesses that use our platform, but businesses that are not on our platform, because we recognize the importance that small businesses are and have to the economy of a country, especially in a country like Nigeria.
All right, so Ada, do you have a figure for Nigeria? Because I know you're looking for 30,000 across Africa. Is there a figure for Nigeria? And do you plan to just divide the 500 million equally, or are you going to use certain indices to determine who gets what?
So it's 30,000 across globally.
Oh, globally.
And what we have dedicated to Nigeria is the sum of 500 million naira. There will be a maximum grant amount. Each grantee will get the same amount of money.
Okay.
And it is a combination of cash and ad credits.
Okay, fantastic.
So apart from this particular grants program, is there any other program that you're doing to support small businesses?
So we have also, we have existing products that we provide to small businesses. And we have scaled up our ability to provide these products to customers. So we have a small business website where you can go to learn free. We have free resources about marketing, about accessing finance, about reaching out to your customers in difficult times like this. And you can find all there is a small business portal on the Facebook platform.
Right. Okay. As we close now on this, Ada, just tell us very quickly in a nutshell, what do I do, where do I go to, and how do I participate? Just very quickly in 10 seconds.
So you go to facebook.com/ grants for businesses.
Okay, fantastic.
And you will see the drop-down menu, select Nigeria, and read through the criteria. And if you're applicable, put in your application.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Ada, for sharing with us this morning. We appreciate it. So we're going to go on a break now. We've been speaking with the head of policy, Anglophone West Africa Facebook, Ada Raikenze. We're going to break. We'll be right back.
Stay tuned. Your View will be right back. Welcome back to Your View.
Thanks for staying with us. So moving on, from the 36 states of Nigeria, including Abuja, there are various women giving their beat to society, doing their best actually, doing outstanding things. Their desire is to make Nigeria a better place. And with little or no support, they are undaunted, yet driven by the desire to be caring, be a caring shoulder to others. In celebration of Nigeria's 60th Independence Business Day, Women's Hub presents Women Champions! Yay! Where a a woman gets nominated as a champion. Regular women doing phenomenal things. Joining us on the show to tell us more about this is the associate editor, Business Day Media Limited, Kemi Ajumobi. Hello, Kemi.
Hi.
Hi, good to have you on the show. So tell us about this. You're looking for 60 outstanding women doing great things. Tell us how you're going to, how you plan to get these women.
Okay, so we just thought, I mean, to be an amazing idea to celebrate 60 women doing phenomenal things. And what we have decided to do is to open a platform where you can nominate yourself or nominate a woman who you know that you qualifies to be among the 60. So what happens is you go to the website, www.tessie.ng, and then you see the flyer there, just click on it and nominate. That's just it. And if you get a business day today, it's also in there. It's, I mean, we give a good page to it. You can see clearly, and you know, just do the needful. Nominate an amazing woman doing fantastic things with her own, you know, little, and using it to help other people. So that's just basically the idea.
Okay, so I'm happy that this is coming out. We need people to recognize what women are doing more. And we have women who are achieving amazing feats in different industries. But I would want something more practical, something that would go a bit further than just recognition. So when you get the 60 people, 60 women, and you celebrate them, is there like a plan to have like a club where they have to start mentoring younger people? Is there any plan, or just after the nominations and celebrations, everybody goes home and we look for the next 60 or next 61 for the next year? Hello?
Kemi, did you get that? Kemi, did you get that?
She's actually talking.
Yeah, we can't hear her.
Kemi, can you hear us?
I mean, we'd love to give them gifts, we'd love to give them money, we'd love to give them things that they can do to enlarge whatever it is that you're doing. So if we get people, I mean, that's also the idea of bringing this out there so we can get people to support, you know, them in any way. So we want to say, you know, let's give them.
Oh, we can't hear Kemi very well. We might have to do this again. Kemi, can you hear us? Hello, Kemi. We're having a bit of network issues, but we might have to get back to you, Kemi. Unfortunately, we're having serious connection. We didn't hear a lot of what she said, but that sounds like an interesting thing to do. And I was going to ask about if it was just regular women, you know, because sometimes you have those who are notable that we already kind of know.
Mm-hmm. But it's people who, yeah.
The ordinary woman.
Yeah, but the ordinary woman doing great things. So it would have been nice to hear her very, but we might have to go on a break while we get that sorted. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Stay tuned. Your View will be right back. Welcome back to Your View.
Thanks for staying with us. So we're still having a bit, we had a bit of technical issue, but we have Kemi Ajumobi back, the Associate Editor of Business Day Media Limited. Kemi, are you still there?
Yes, I am.
Yeah, so we're asking before the break, how do you intend to...
To continue after the recognition, is there any plan to like set up a group of these women and for them to mentor other younger women? Or is just for recognition?
Yes, that's actually the idea. Whatever project it is that they are doing is enough to catch our attention. It's the reason why they are actually, you know, applying, I mean, to be nominated. So the idea is to follow up with them, you know, to know how far they're going, how, you know, the exposure and whatever it is that they get as gifts is helping, you know, to better whatever it is that they are doing, and how they are also ensuring that they are going to, you know, encourage other people to do something like what they're doing, because it's about impacting your community.
Right.
Go on again.
We can't hear you, Kemi.
That's the idea, to ensure that there's continuity and that other people are also encouraged to do, you know, what is being done and even more.
All right. Thank you very much, Kemi, unfortunately, but we still have to bring you back again because we're having a bit of technical issues. But it'd be great to have you back at some time to give us a proper insight on how these women will be selected and then all the various things you're going to do for them afterwards. Unfortunately, at this time, we have to let you go. Thank you so much, Kemi, for joining us this morning. So we'll be moving on now to our next guest, who actually will be talking to us about street food. So we all get tempted by the smells and sights of street food as we walk past. However, despite our temptations, many of us are skeptical about whether it's safe to eat it or not. Now, join us to discuss how healthy our street food is Chairman, Nigerian Institute of Food Science and Technology, Lagos State Chapter, Mr. Sunday Bamgbose. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Murayo.
Good to have you on the show. Sir, we are very, very skeptical about having this conversation with you because it's almost like you want to discredit the ataswe-swe and the boli and the suya we are eating
akara.
On the road. And the akara, the hot oil. Please, sir, what is your issue with street food?
Well, we don't have issue with street food. Just like you, almost all of us, we enjoy patronizing this street food. But what we realize in the Nigerian Institute of Food Science and Technology is that while the industry have regulatory bodies that regulate their activities, these street food vendors, they don't have such. So we identify this as a gap. And that is why we stepped in, sensitizing the vendors on how to keep their food safe. We recognize that many people across the country patronize these street food vendors. But if you look at the level of hygiene, the level of awareness among these street food vendors, it is very low. And that is why we stepped in. How did we step in?
Go ahead, sir.
Yeah, some years back, what we did, we trained some of our members as street food vendors. And these street food vendors, they adopted, you know, street food champions. These street food champions adopted street food vendors around their locality. And then we were able to cover about 7 local governments in Lagos State. But subsequently, we went into the next phase of it, whereby we were visiting markets. We did that sometimes in June last year, and then we did another one February this year. During this outreach, we teach the food vendors on the rule of hygiene. We gave them hand gloves, ear net, nose mask. In fact, before COVID started and face mask was mandated, we've started, you know, with our street food vendors,
right,
teaching them the importance of using this.
Right.
Yes, I was going to ask, there's a school of thought that believes that Nigerians have developed antibodies towards this street food. So by the time you now make it
hygienic,
we will start to be dying like chicken. Because it's those things that give us the ajesara. You understand? That's,
well,
let me finish. You know, that's when you eat the thing. Like, I went to go and eat one food yesterday. Ah, they said that the scarf we saw the day before was the same scarf she used to wipe the leaf.
For the rice.
Well, I'm still not sick this morning. You know, in fact, I'm even having problem. I haven't been to the loo.
So, yeah.
Answer that, please.
Well, let me correct that myth. It is not true. Yes, maybe sometimes when you are exposed continuously, continually to certain germs, you develop some level of immunity.
Mm.
But like we know, the world has gone global. We do travel to other countries. We want to try what they eat there. The same way when you have people coming from other places, when they see the level of hygiene that we practice, it will encourage them to be part of what we are doing. They will want to have a taste.
Right.
We've seen, you know, global personalities visit Nigeria and they go on the street. They want to be part of what is happening on the street. And apart from that, when you look at, there are many people that come down with several illnesses that they may not know is coming from the food they've been eating. You remember the prevalence of Lassa fever, the prevalence of typhoid fever. These are things that, you know, diseases that you get from eating contaminated food.
Okay, all right. So, but there's also another myth which I grew up with, which says that once the food is cooked, the heat from the fire will kill any form of disease. And that's why women confidently let their children have all of these street food. So what do you have to say about it? The heat that comes from the food, does it kill some of the germs at least?
Yes, it is true. But look at it this way. Take, for example, somebody frying akara. The akara comes from the fire, hot. But the person eating may not eat it immediately. And then take, for example, the paper that they use in packing the akara.
Newspapers.
The paper may have been contaminated. So while the heat, yes, we have in a large, you know, to a large extent, it doesn't guarantee that you are eating safe food.
Right. Now, so for someone like me, I'm a roasted corn addict. I like roasted corn. I can't pass. I have to stop and buy. But I always worry. There's somewhere at the back of my mind, I worry that all the carbon monoxide, all the air, all the particles, they have gathered already on that corn I'm about to buy. So when I buy the corn, I first of all heat it and dust off all the corn, thinking that that's removed all the particles. Would you say roasted corn is safe to eat, even though we don't cook it?
After heating it.
Well, like, you know, the last question.
Amboli.
The process of the heat, you know, will help to maybe reduce the microbial load. But when they are packing this for you, they put it in a paper. You don't know where that paper has been to. You don't know whether somebody has taken that paper to a toilet before. You don't know, as you are going on the road, the vehicle passing, they raise up dust. And we are talking of, you know, germs that we cannot see with our physical eyes. So these are the dangers. And these are some of the things that we identify as problem, and we try, you know, to educate the food vendors.
So what's
and
your...
make it safer.
Right.
Yeah, you talked about paper, but I know that leaf, a lot of Africans use leaf, like moi moi in leaf, rice. The rice I ate yesterday was in leaf, and that leaf makes the food sweeter somehow. You know, the moi moi cooked in plastic is horrible.
So is it better? So is it safer?
So what about leaf as an option to the paper?
Well, if you are talking of moi moi, Yeni, in the case of moi moi, you remember that you have to cook the moi moi with the leaf.
Yes.
So because you are cooking the moi moi with the leaf, whatever germ is on that leaf will die, you know, in the process of cooking.
Right.
That is when you talk of moi moi. You know, for each situation, you look at it, you know, on its own merit. It is not one case fit all.
Okay. All right. Yeah, so the roadside sellers are not just part of the problem. We still have those ones who hawk the food. So they make the food in their different houses, and then you carry it on the streets and people buy.
Okay.
Is there any plan to get them into, like, maybe this association and, you know, re-educate them on how they can be hygienic in preparing that food? Because you don't see where they prepare the food that they sell.
Yes, this is where, you know, our institute try to come in. When we educate the food vendors, they will be able to identify the areas of hazard coming from their food preparation, in storage of the food, after cooking, and where the hazard lies. So when they know about this, they'll be able to do something, you know, to reduce the risk, to reduce the, for example, if you are buying food on the street, you have some people that put the food in cooler and relatively the food is still very hot. In that case, you have some level of protection. But when you are buying food and the food is cold, then you may need to microwave it before you eat.
Wow.
If you eat it like that, you may run into a problem.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So these are the things that, you know, the areas where our institute, we are trying to address.
We have to wrap up with you now, but could you finally just tell us the activities your institute is putting together to ensure sensitization and equipping these roadside sellers too on how they can be more hygienic?
Well, we go to markets. We partner with some Lagos State departments. For example, the last market visit we did at Cairo Market, Oshodi, we have some officers from Lagos Safety Commission being part of that activity. And if not because of the COVID that slowed down everybody, we will have gone into maybe the next phase.
Okay.
But we have our annual conference coming up between 14th and 15th of October in Lagos here. And the theme is Agro and Food Processing for Wealth Creation, the Nigerian Experience. And safety of street food will be one of the cardinal issues that we'll still be discussing.
Okay.
And that's by all stakeholders.
All right. Thank you very much, sir, for joining us this morning. We appreciate your thoughts on this. Let's go. We'll be speaking with the chairman, Nigerian Institute of Food Science and Technology, Lagos Chapter, Mr. Sunday Banguji. We're going to go on a break. When we come back, ex-minister Femi Fani-Kayode verbally attacked one of our own. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Stay tuned. Your View will be right back. Back to Your View.
Thanks for staying with us. So it seems the President of the United States of America, Donald Trump, has started influencing quite a bit of our leaders. So recently, the former Minister of Aviation, Femi Fani-Kayode, was at a press conference in Calabar Cross River State. At the conference, a journalist, Charles, had asked a question about who was bankrolling Fani-Kayode's trip. But the former minister felt offended by the question and allegedly went ahead to insult the journalist. However, we recently just found out that he has apologized to the journalist on a Twitter he sent this morning. But before we go into exactly the video, I'd like to, the ladies of Your View, to you know, to tell us exactly, for those of you that have not even watched the clip at all. So please.
The actors. So we're here to act, okay. Enact this role.
So
sir, I am aware that you have traveled to about 6 or 7 states and now you are here in Cross River to, you know, supervise the projects of these governors. Please, sir, who is bankrolling you?
What? What kind of question is that? Are you stupid?
I'm sorry, sir.
What do you mean?
I'm sorry, sir. It was just a question,
do you know who I am?
Sir.
Look, do you know who I am? Do you know who you're talking to?
I'm sorry.
Look at me. Look at you.
Mikey, what? He didn't say that one. He didn't say, look at you.
Yeah,
let's watch the clip on your nose. Let's watch it.
No, put that thing down. Let me address. What? Bankrolling who? Do you know who you are talking to? Bank. I will not take any questions from this man. What type of insulting question is that? Which bankroll? To do what? Who can give me money for anything? Who do you think you are talking to?
I'm sorry, sir.
Bankroll what? Go and report yourself to your publisher. Bankroll what? Please don't insult me here.
Okay, gentlemen.
I don't want to take any questions from this man. I could see from your face before you got here, have you ever talked to me like that? Who do you think you are talking to? Bankroll who? You think that I'm one of those ones you'll be... From who? From how? When? Where? How? You have a small mind. Very small mind. Don't judge me by your own standards. I've been in politics since 1990. I'm not one of these politicians you think will just come. I've been locked up how many times by this government? Suffered. I've been persecuted. Unlike most of the politicians.
Thanks for that. So many have described his response as uncouth, disrespectful, and quite insulting. But others have said maybe the question was not appropriate. But the question people are asking is that you're not a government official. You're not in any capacity of a government appointee. And suddenly you're going around the country inspecting what the governors have done. Mm. So some will say it was a right, it was an apt question to say, who is funding this? You are going around. On what capacity are you going around the country inspecting people's projects? So was that a valid question, YK, would you say?
I think that maybe the way the journalist phrased the question, let me put it like this. I don't want to go whether it's a valid question or not, because when, if you look at me now and say, you are a thief, and I know I'm not a thief, I will say, you too, you are a thief. Get out, idiot. I will laugh it off. But if I have something to hide.
Hey, reverse psychology.
I will get angry.
Aha. Mm-hmm. So you're suggesting that maybe there's somebody that's bankrolling.
I'm not suggesting anything.
Why can you suggest?
I'm just saying that annoyance was like annoyance of, hey,
how did
what?
You know?
Mm. How dare you?
Like he struck a chord.
Yes. Mm. Exactly. Mm. You know?
That response was true. So it just showed that there's a possibility. We don't know. We're still alleging that maybe that young man struck a chord by that question. And that can suggest to anybody who is looking that, maybe there is somebody bankrolling this. But let me come to you, Beecee.
So I think from his own perspective, that question was an attack on his ego and his person. Because you cannot ask a private individual who is bankrolling you for a trip that he can ordinarily afford. It's like I decide to travel to 6 states or 7 states to do something as a private individual. And you're asking me who is sponsoring me. Are you saying I cannot sponsor myself? That was how he took the question. And probably one of the reasons he reacted that way. So what happens
is... So you think his reaction was reasonable?
Yes. The way the question, so what happens is when you communicate, you are encoding a message. Now, you have done your part by communicating. It's left for the person who you have communicated to decode exactly what it is you were trying to say. Mm. So sometimes there's a misinterpretation along the way. If he had coined that question better. Okay, you're traveling, you've gone to this place, you've gone to that place. In what capacity, as a private individual or as a government official, how are you traveling? Would have elicited a different response to who is bankrolling you. Are you saying I cannot, no, just understand the mindset. Mm-hmm. Are you saying my kind of person, I cannot sponsor myself for 5 or 6 trips but across Nigeria? How much is the ticket fare?
I hear you, BC, but when you call a press briefing, One of the things about press briefing is that you never know what the journalist is going to ask.
Yeah.
That's why you go there prepared. Mm. They can throw you darts. They can throw you anything. You must be prepared. For as a leader who has been an ex-minister, shouldn't you comport yourself? Even though you feel offended, there's a sense of leadership. Mm. There's a sense of be the bigger man in certain things where it gives you that control over your utterance. Mm-hmm. Let me take this call from Yakub. I'll come to you, YK. Yakub, are you there?
Yeah, I'm there, Morayo. Good morning.
You're live. Go ahead, please.
Mr. Ayoni, good morning.
Good morning, sir.
Morayo, I'm not surprised at all. You see, Morayo, this is kind of the politician we have in this country. We have the good one and then we have the bad one. Let me tell you, Morayo, this is a person that always attacks leadership in this country, telling us that we lack leadership. Okay, Morayo, tell me now. Look at what he said. What is the role of leadership in the statement I uttered as a journalist? Mm. Journalists ask you who bankrolling who? Who bankrolling you? The issue is that tell him the Nigerian wants to know. The journalists are doing the very great job for us in this country. Apart from if there's not a journalist in this country, Mariah will club be in darkness. You see, Mr. Allen, I've already knocked the nail in the right place. If you had something to hide in your cupboard, that is how you will respond to a journalist asking a question. As if I'm a dad journalist, I will reply him because he's a man like me. It is a woman.
Right.
I'm happy that Yakub went there. Mm. I'm happy because that is the mistake that journalist made. When he faced him, why? He was...
Yes, sir. Sullen. Yeah.
No, sir. Sorry, sir. What for? If you know and you have confidence in your question, excuse me, sir, do not insult me. I have not insulted you. Mm. And that is where I think that our young men should start to stand up to these people. When you stand up to these people,
they will stop insulting you. Stop. He talks about brown envelopes. There I have a problem with the publishers of newspapers and TV houses. Mm. Make your journalists pay them well, one. Mm. Make them, look, when you, the dressing girl, you that you want to ask the question.
Packaging.
Mm. Ah, packaging.
See, someone said he should have picked on someone on his own side. Imagine it was a Showore that was there. Would he talk to you? Would Showore ask you a question? Now go back and say, are you stupid? So it depends. So you pick. So he was picking on somebody who obviously could not defend himself.
Okay.
Because you know the kind of person you can talk that, say that to.
So I disagree with the way he attacked the journalist. It was more like going to a spoon fight with a gun. You know, you came with a gun. We're exchanging spoons and we're hitting spoons, and then you come with a gun. That's the levels are just too different. I agree on that aspect. But I also want to say that as journalists, we have been trained to understand your guest. You naturally do not bring in your guest to embarrass your guest. Mm. So in preparing your questions, you need to be more forward-thinking, proactive. You need to apply emotional intelligence. So you should have known that this man has a temper. It's not today we've heard or we've seen the way he... So you, in preparing for those questions, you balance yourself in such a way that even if he decides to, you know, show you have a cushion to help you, that's on the part of the journalist. But for him as a leader, the truth is, no matter how much we come out and show ourselves as we're leaders, we're still human beings. Right. And we all react different ways when certain things come.
All right. Let me take this call from Debola. Is holding for a while. Debola, go ahead, please.
Yeah, good morning. Auntie Mario.
Yes.
Yeah, I really appreciate your comment and your program. I've been watching, I've been first time caller.
Welcome to the show.
Yeah, Auntie Annie, are you listening?
Good morning, I'm listening.
All right. Who is Bankrolling you?
Yes, sir, that's the hashtag.
Ha!
Who's Bankrolling me? is Wari? Wari is one Bankrolling me.
But you know what?
Let Aisha catch you.
Our former minister has already, accused that guy as well, because he said it's different from some politician that is giving them brown envelope. Mm. And the guy said nothing. He has already responded negatively to that guy. But meanwhile, a leader must show an example.
Yeah.
Rasan. And I don't think that, that guy has already protected himself as a leader.
Mm.
That is former minister.
Right.
So,
thank you very much for your thoughts on that. Many of us are used to FFK's venomous utterances. Even since the time he was a spokesperson, we know him.
Mm-hmm.
Go to his Facebook page, he's there spewing everything you can, everything that is totally, that you can actually disregard as distasteful in many ways. However, I think it behooves on you as a leader, because when you're in the public space, people are listening.
Mm-hmm.
Because we talk about hate speech. We talk about, what's the other one? Hate speech. There's another one that our Minister of Information...
Fake news.
Fake news and all that. So the point is that you as a leader, somebody can see this as hate speech on television. You're calling the person idiot. You actually insulted him. Somebody can say that's hate speech. So, but the point is, as a leader, many leaders in Nigeria, we lack that public awareness of how to compose yourself and comport yourself when you're speaking. Many of them lose their temper on air. You shouldn't lose your temper.
That is the problem, you see. Let's forget FFK for now.
Yes.
Let's talk about Nigeria in general.
Yes.
When you have more money than the next man, you always feel that you are better.
Yes. Mm. Hallelujah.
And you, that you have less, you always look up just because that person has more money than you.
Yeah.
Just because of maybe he will throw me some crumbs.
Mm.
I don't need your crumbs, man.
Yeah.
And that is what we have to learn, that we have to be proud of who we are, no matter where you come from or what you are, how poor or rich you are, be proud of who and what you are.
Exactly. Mm,
and that's where Charles, I think, should not have... Why was he bowing? Why was he bowing and scraping? I would have said, eh?
But the other gentleman,
he could have just rephrased the question.
It would have been insult to insult.
No, that's not necessary.
Come and ask me that. Come and do that kind of thing.
That's not necessary. I think.
He will not call him stupid. He will not call him. But you say, excuse me, sir.
Right.
You cannot talk to me like that. I refuse I refuse to be part of this press conference. And I hope that my fellow journalists agree with me and walk out, because I'm staging a walkout now. Mm-hmm. Well, he will be ashamed.
Okay, let's take a few tweets.
So Ehiwan says, no going from state to state. He said, says no. Going from state to state to inspect public sector project is not something a private citizen does. I'm sure you've never done so and can't cite an example of anyone who has. The question was apt. Kennedy Igwe says, according to the cable, the question was, you have not disclosed to us who is bankrolling you. This question is unfairly presumptive, for it comes with the conclusion, even though not proven. The real Fani-Kayode was being bankrolled, hence the question was inappropriate.
Yes. His response obviously just suggests that.
His response, you see, I don't even see anything wrong in him going from state to state. If state to state, if I had the money and I want to be a critic of government, I will go from state to state.
To supervise, to monitor.
So that when I'm attacking government, I'm attacking on the place of knowledge.
Okay.
Not, Obi Ajulu said she went to Benin yesterday, and this is what she said. Moriah said she went to Abeokuta. No, I will go and see for myself.
Okay.
So I do not see anything wrong in him going from. So when he wants to start yabbing government,
he will yab very well.
Yeah. Yes, yabbing from a place of knowledge. But when you are doing that kind of job, you should be able to take any kind of question.
Yes. Mm. And if indeed it's your money that you're using, if they ask you, you say, of course I'm bankrolling myself. Why would you think anybody's bankrolling me? This is my own public service I'm doing.
Okay.
But if someone is really bankrolling you, you get defensive.
No, get annoyed. I don't think so. I don't think that's what happened. I think, you know, sometimes when we receive, it depends on the mood that you find yourself for a particular day. Sometimes you receive an information and it lands on the wrong side of the brain and then you give it back. And we know how sometimes, we know how sometimes most, we see as statements come out that are not true, and then people are just quiet. They don't want you to defend yourself. They don't want you to say anything just to take the higher ground. Yeah. And sometimes we have the president of America who doesn't take the higher ground.
Okay,
he will give it to you back to back.
So we have to wrap up on this. We have to wrap up. But I think Nigerians are still asking the same question.
Who
Mr.
is
Mr. Femi Fani-Kayode? Wrap up on this. We have to wrap up. But I think Nigerians are still asking the same question.
Who
Mr.
is
Mr. Femi Fani-Kayode? Who is bankrolling you? See you tomorrow. Have a fabulous day.
Yo, Moriah.